Welcome, friends, back to this afternoon session. In the morning, I was mentioning that when you want to try to do something, you are doing something mental with your mind. All trying is mental. You cannot try to be spiritual. Yet we are constantly trying. I am trying hard on meditation. I am trying everything to do to become spiritual. Spirituality does not lie within trying. And if you stop trying, then nothing happens. What a great dilemma we are in. We can neither try nor not try. Then what happens? I mentioned to you that we are seekers. We seek something. Now, seeking has double meaning. Seeking can also mean searching, which is mental. Or seeking can be I am waiting for something to come, which is also seeking. When you are waiting for something, you are not trying. Waiting, you are not trying. So when you wait for something to happen, and you are waiting for that which is your true home, waiting for your true self, not waiting for anything you want to get in this physical world, then the response to that waiting is also part of seeking. Because you are seeking something but not trying. Now, the one thing that can pull you without trying that exists in this world is a beautiful thing called love. People, when they want to love, they try. When they are not wanting to love but getting loved, they are not trying. A true seeker gets loved, not tries to love, but experiences love. Now, this is a very catchy thing because we are using the word love all the time, even for things to which we are attached. I love my house. When you say, I love my house, what is in your mind? I love my house. Three things. You are the one who's saying, I love an action or something I'm doing for a house. Or I love my children, love my friend, I love you. All these involve three things. If somebody falls in love with you, you don't feel that at all, the three things. You only feel I'm being loved. The singularity comes only when you are not thinking of more than one. If you fall in love with somebody, truly love, not an attachment or not something, what have you done for me, I'll do for you, not those kind of things. If you fall truly in love with somebody, what happens in your head is the thought about the beloved. The I disappears. You don't have time for I. The beloved, constantly the thought is about the beloved, if it's true love. You will notice that there's a big difference between attachment, in which the I is foremost, and love, true love, where I is at the back. The ego is at the back. Most of the time, we are talking of love as an ego game, which is mind's game. It's trying. But when you are actually loved, or you feel that without doing anything, without trying, then that is true love. What happens when we are searching for our own true self? Our own true self, which we don't even know about. We are thinking our body is our own true self. We are thinking our mind is our own true self. That I think, therefore I am. We are constantly engaged in these three forms of ours, the body, the senses, and our mind, and identifying them as ourself. The self is what is making all these alive. The soul is the self. When you are seeking the self, the self appears in your experience outside, because you don't look inside. Therefore, the self, your own self, appears outside and appears as another person, human being. And that human being is a little different from other human beings, because when you are around that human being, there seems to be a pull coming without your trying. Such a human being we are calling a perfect living master. Perfect living master is not a real separate being. It's just a representation in our human life of our own true self. When do we find that this is really true, that this is not another person but ourself? When we go within our own self. At the very first stage, when we discover our inner self other than this body, we find the same human being there. Some others may be there, some may not, but that being is there. When we go higher to the mental self, that human being is still there. When we go to the spiritual self, our own soul, the human being is still there, which we saw as a physical plane. When we go to the top, we find there was no other human being, it was our own self. Our own true self is our master. We don't know our true self. Therefore, by our own arrangement, we are so made that when we are here in the physical plane, he appears as somebody separate from us as a perfect living master, and he represents our true self at the top. It's a very beautifully made arrangement. I could not, with my best effort, make a better arrangement than this to discover our own self. That is why, what is the role of a perfect living master? The role is simply to give you an experience of pure, unconditional love. That which is part of your own characteristic form, characteristic nature of the soul. The soul does some things. To distinguish the soul from the mind, it's very simple. The mind always operates in time and space. Even the smallest thought takes time. Love happens immediately, spontaneously, without time. Intuition happens without time. It's a spiritual experience. It happens only with the soul. Sudden appreciation of beauty, sudden appreciation of his form of beauty, of any form, spiritual exercise. These do not operate in time, they happen at once. Others all take time, even the smallest thought takes time, all mental activities take time. Therefore, the true spiritual path is a path that lies through the experience of an unconditional love of a perfect living master. If you are a true seeker of your true self, he will appear in your life without your trying. You will have tried many times to find masters, but the one who is going to pull you will appear by himself, by coincidences, by circumstances, by strange coincidences. And that is why this is an amazing thing, that the perfect living master is a human being like ourselves, totally like ourselves, born like us, dies like us, gets sick like us, eats, drinks like us, is just like us, an ordinary human being. The only difference in the perfect living master and ourselves is his level of awareness. He's aware at all times of all levels of awareness. All the levels are with us also. He had nothing unusual. He does not have anything extraordinary that we don't have. The only extraordinary thing is he is awakened and aware of those levels, and we are not. And we are trying to struggle through the mind to get those awarenesses, whereas those awarenesses don't come so easily just by trying. So that is why a perfect living master comes into our life to give us experience of perfect unconditional love. I emphasize the word unconditional, because the attachments that we have, we use words like love, I love you, they are all conditional. If somebody, you say I love you, the other person, I hate you, then you say I also hate you. Not that kind of love. But a perfect living master. When he appears in your life, you will have a pull, feeling of pull. If you don't, he's not your master. Don't run after that person. If a pull comes, he's your master. There can be several perfect living masters around us, but one for us, who comes at the stage of our spiritual journey when we have tried everything else up to the mental level. That means we have found many masters. According to our Indian scriptures, every child born has four masters. First is the mother, teaches the child. Then there is a school teacher. Then there is a teacher in the temple or the church. Then there is a spiritual teacher. Everybody has four masters. Among spiritual teachers, the perfect living masters tell us there can be so many grades of masters, some taking you only through out-of-body experience, which can be out-of-body experience at the emotional level, at heart chakras, at other chakras, at the energy levels, an energy experience of outer body, or it can be actual out-of-body experience. We are not connected with the body at all at the astral level. Then there are other masters who take you to the universal mind, ultimate creative power, and they call it our true home. Those are also, in our terms, perfect masters. Then they are perfect masters who show us that our true form is the soul and not the body. They are also masters. Then there are perfect living masters who take us to our true home, where there is totality of consciousness. There is only one. There is no two. There you find that the whole of this experience of multitude of universes is coming from one single source. And we are part of that source. And we start with being part of the source, and then we discover we are the whole source. That's perfect living master. They appear in our life when our sights are set at that high point. When our sights are at a lower point, other masters come. It does not mean that a master who is not the highest master is not our master. He is our master at that stage. At that part of our life, he is a master. But when we want to move forward and think we haven't got enough, our soul itself tells us that we are not satisfied, we want to move more. Another master appears, takes us further. It's a journey. It's just like going to school. If a child says, oh, my cousin goes to college, I don't want to go to school, I want to go to college. The child has to go to school first. We are all like that on the spiritual path. So that is why it's the unconditional love that takes us beyond the mind. That is why some people say God is love. Our true reality is love. They've been talking about all this, but these are words we haven't experienced. You want to experience unconditional love? When a perfect living master appears and you feel the pull, you will see if you love that master, he loves you. If you don't love that master, he loves you. If you hate that master, he loves you. If you kill that master, he loves you. That's the kind of unconditional love you get from a perfect living master. You don't get that from anywhere else. You don't get from the other masters even. So that is why this is the secret. The true spiritual path is a path of love and devotion. Now I added one more word. Not to cause confusion, I'm adding this word because when you feel love, you automatically respond to it. The response is called devotion. Love and devotion means an experience and its response. When we feel the love, we automatically become devotees. We don't have to do any particular kind of devotion. We automatically like to do something that is good for the experience we are having. We automatically become devoted. That is why love and devotion is the key. And the perfect living masters, they want to teach us only the real experience of love and devotion, but our mind says, but what are we supposed to do? Then, okay, then meditate. Then struggle. Oh, that makes sense. If you try hard, you'll get something. You can't get anything without struggle. So they are telling the right thing. Masters are giving us these teachings, including meditation, only for our mind. The soul does not need meditation. soul only needs love. Love is the answer, no matter what the question is. Love is the answer to your seeking, and that is what ultimately takes you. And that's the biggest experience that you get from a perfect living master. I can remember the pull that this great master had on people. They couldn't even realize what was happening to them. I often quote the example of a professor that I knew. The professor came to great master to tell him that what you are teaching is wrong. He came one Sunday during the discourse, and after the discourse said, "Master, whatever you have said today is utterly wrong. There are no higher regions. This physical body is the only body, and there is no evidence at all for what you are saying. We are scientists, we are professors, we understand things on a scientific basis. Therefore, you come up with all these stories. These gurus have made up all the stories just to fleece people of their money and to just get followers for themselves. And I can tell you, as a professor, that there is no truth in what you are saying. Please don't deceive these people." And great master said, "Professor, I appreciate your honesty. I appreciate your understanding of whatever you have understood. But my experience is different. We can have different experiences. My experience is different. But thank you very much for your honest opinion." Professor went away. Next Sunday he was back and told the master the same things again. He said, "Master, I have come to tell you, please don't teach these things to people. There is no fundamental basis for it. There is no evidence for it. We believe in evidence." Then the master said, "Professor, you came last time also, and I told you that we can have different experiences, therefore different opinions. My experience is very different from yours, and that is why I share my experience with people." Third Sunday, the professor was back. He said, "Professor, you came twice to tell me the same thing. Now you come third time." The professor said, "I don't know, but somehow I feel like coming back to you again and again." And he became one of his finest disciples later. I still remember something else he told me. And he became good friends. He was also a friend of my father and also became my friend. He was younger than my father. Then when he was dying in hospital, he sent for me. And he called me and said, "I want to tell you something, young man. When you have a master, please ask for the best things from him." He said, "I made a big mistake. After reading the scriptures and all that, I thought it's very bad to be a rich man, can't go to heaven at all. I found that the real thing is a sacrifice on the spiritual path. So I told great master, 'Master, give me poverty, give me sickness, give me all the humbleness to be at your feet.' He gave me poverty. I couldn't get a job after that. He gave me sickness. I'm going to die with the sickness. And he gave me humility, which was not true humility at all. I was trying to be very proud of the fact that I got sickness and poverty. No humility even came. Please don't ask for these things. Ask for the best things in life. Say, 'Master, you are the master of everything. Give me the best here and hereafter.'" I got a big lesson from him. And I said, "Yes, I'll ask for the best." And the master gave me the best. So that is why the master who loves unconditionally is also our best friend. We can't have a better friend than the master. And the master, when he initiates us, accepts us, he sits inside us forever till we reach the ultimate home, true home. So that is why this is the secret. People asked the great master, "Tell us in a short way the spiritual path." He says, "Spiritual path starts with a perfect living master, continues with a perfect living master. That's the spiritual path. The spiritual path is the master. But the mind won't accept it. The mind says, if I have to realize my own self, I don't need a third party outside. If I have to meet my God, who they say is inside you, I don't need an outside agent to help me to find God. I can find God myself. Therefore, the mind tends to reject this. And therefore, our journey becomes longer and longer. There is nothing that extends our journey further than is needed than our own mind. There is no outside enemy coming to help, to come in our way. Our own mind becomes our enemy, and our own mind is what we have to tackle with. It is only the love that we experience from a master that ultimately takes care of our doubts, takes care of our mind. With our own effort, we get more into a jumble, more into more thinking, more discrepancies in everything that we see, more contradictions. Even in the books we read, mind can create all that situation. But the love overpowers, and we forget about the questions, we forget about the books, we forget about everything, and just move towards our true home. So I wanted to share this experience with you and keep it in mind. I am told there are a few questions that Jonathan has. I'll take up a few.
How important is it for one's spiritual development that your spouse follow the same spiritual path?
How important is it for one's spiritual development that your spouse follow the same spiritual path? Thank you. It's written thank you here. Thank you. Each one of us carries our own destiny. A spouse is linked by our destiny. Therefore, for a certain period of time, we run together on that destiny. If both husband and wife are on the same spiritual path, it cuts away some friction and cuts away some disputes on this, and therefore it's helpful. But the actual progress within is done individually, and it does not matter if the other person is doing it or not. The spiritual development is a process that takes place within our own self, not outside. But the only thing is that some obstacles that come by argument and by disputes, they get removed if both of them are on the same spiritual path.
If I use my money to buy food for someone and they choose to order non-vegetarian food, will I be affected karma-wise?
If I use my money to buy food for someone and they choose to order non-vegetarian food, will I be affected by karma-wise? If you think about it, yes. If you don't think about it, you give them the money, then no. The karma is created by the intention in our thinking. When we intend to do something, it creates karma. If you follow up with the intention and act, it enhances the karma. But the karma is created in the mind. And if you have given money to somebody, what they do, you do not know. There's no karma. If you know or try to find out where did you spend the money, then you're having karma.
Can you please explain in detail how to stay at the third eye center while listening to the sound?
Can you please explain in detail how to stay at the third eye center while listening to the sound? Once you start listening to the sound in the third eye center, after that, forget the third eye center. Don't continuously try to look for third eye center. It's only for the beginning, to center yourself. Once you are there, when your body disappears, when the whole experience around you disappears, even the whole notion where third eye center disappears. And you just continue to act whatever you are doing in that body at that time. If you are hearing the sound, continue to listen to the sound. Sound will pull you to a new experience without your bothering about third eye center.
Are there any karmic implications of donating body organs, physical body, for medical research? People say that some organs retain life consciousness for some time after death. So does the timing matter? Also, does the organ receiver inherit the behavior characteristics from the donor?
Are there any karmic implications of donating body organs, physical body, for medical research? No karmic obligation, but donating your body. Body is, when you talk of body, I suppose you're talking of dead body, right? Yeah. You are not dead body at all. You're not even using dead body. Where the dead body goes has no karmic implication at all. People say that some organs retain life consciousness for some time after death. So does the timing matter? Also, does the organ receive, inherit the behavior characteristics from the donor? No, the body is completely away from yourself. Therefore, what happened to the body is immaterial. The organs by themselves only work with the life that has been given to them. Some organs can keep on having a reaction after death, but that is not life. Therefore, don't think that the organs have got their own life, none at all. When you die, the body dies, the body has nothing in it.
Where do animals go when they die?
Where do animals go when they die? They go to the next life. These animal lives, insect lives, bird lives, angels' lives, all life forms other than the human life are created from intentions and actions done in human life. None of their actions are creating any karma. So we call what them, we call it karmjuni and bhogjuni, which means the form in which we can create karma and the forms in which we can pay off karma. The form in which we can create karma is only one, human form. The form in which we can pay off are 8.4 million minus one. So you can imagine how much karma a human being can create to require 8.4 million types of forms to pay off. That is because we are creating karma continuously in our mind by thinking, I can do that, I do that, I am not sure. All the intentions we are making in our mind every day are adding up and piling up as karma. And that is why the karma, the nature of karma, the type of karma determines what form you can take in order to pay off. It's not always human form. So that is why, if you have to take other forms, supposing one person dies and his karma requires that he should have four lifetimes. One lifetime is not enough. Four lifetimes. Three of an insect, one of a bird, and then a human being again to get the next chance. Then every time, as it happens, according to the Indian scripture, the order in which you go through these lives will be insects first, bird later, mammal later, then human. Which means, to some extent, Darwin's idea of evolution fits in with the karmic law that we notice actually takes place. So one can be born in many forms. One can be born in angels also. One can be born in even the rulers of the higher planets and higher stages, even rulers of astral and causal planes, they're also based on karma. So karma can create big rewards and big punishments. In the astral plane, there are actually hells and heavens both existing, number of them. Some people have only seen one heaven, one hell, but there are many heavens and hells, which meditators can see more easily. They can go and examine, but my suggestion is don't go to the hells. I remember one famous Bibi of great master, and once she in meditation started howling, crying. And we had to open her door, break it open to a little house. She lived next to our house in the Dera. And she was crying and howling. She wouldn't answer to us, so we had to go to Great Master, call him. He came and he said, "Where are you, Bibi?" And she said, "I am in hell." "How did you go there?" "Out of curiosity." He said, "Are they hurting you? Anybody hurting you?" "No." "Then why are you screaming and crying?" "Because they can't even see the torture they are inflicting on other people there here." So she described the actual state in hell very vividly. And we were all listening, wondering if this is really what is happening here. And then Great Master said, "Why don't you repeat the 5 words I gave you?" She said, "I've forgotten them." "Can you hear my voice?" he said. She said, "Yes, follow my voice." And then she opened her eyes, then she put her head on his feet. And then he told us, sitting around there, just 10 people or so, "Don't out of curiosity say we'll examine where is hell, because you may not be able to stand it. And heavens, yes, you can visit once in a while and enjoy them. That's okay in meditation." So that is why the animals are not deciding where to go. They follow the pattern that has been created for the successive one form of life to another till they go back to human again. Last question.
Do non-PLM masters have radiant forms? Do their initiates see their radiant form during meditation? Does a non-PLM master come at time of death to take their initiate? 3 questions.
What was the last comment you made?
They snuck in 3 questions in one.
Which one is the last one? I want to read one of them. Read the most important one. Boy, it is his quote.
New question. Does a non-PLM master come at time of death to take their initiate?
Yes, any master can come at the time of death. Not only a master, anybody you love can come at the time of death. What brings those people from the other side, as they call it, which means the astral state? When a person dies, that person is actually in a state where it may not be immediately reborn in a new body, but can stay in a disembodied state. And that state is accessible to all those who die till they are born again. And supposing somebody, you love somebody, and they also love you, which means they are attached to you, they remain close to you. So when you die, they appear. So many people die and they can see dead people around them because they were all around them. What brings them to you is attachment or love. When you are attached to something, it comes. When you love something, somebody, they come. So perfect living masters always appear to take you forward because they separate your life from the life of others. Others have to follow a different route. That means they have to follow a route for reincarnation in a proper form. The perfect living masters make sure that you don't go through that route, but they determine if you need another life or not. If you find that you have done enough of your payoff of your karma for the life, which is part of the program, that you have paid off part of your karma that was needed, and a little bit left can be paid off in the astral plane, or a little bit more can be paid off in the causal plane. They rearrange that so you're not reborn again at all. Perfect living masters always try to make sure you're not come back again. Because from there to take you back with a perfect living master is much easier than come back here, be reborn again, be found by another master and go. It's a long process. So that's the only difference. Otherwise, if you love a master who is not a perfect living master, he will appear. Thank you very much for your patient listening. We'll see you next month.